and in a while. If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired word of God, and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate, and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today. And we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Good morning. Welcome to Open Door Church. Everybody ready to worship? Yeah. We just invite you to stand to your feet, and we're just going to start singing some praise to Jesus this morning.
All right. Let's everyone rise.
Love will never fade.
that amazing? The living creator of all lives inside of us, and he springs up like a well, and it never runs dry. It is incredible to serve the amazing God that we serve. We are so glad to have you in the house this morning here at Open Door Church. Do we have any guests with us for the first time? Would you raise your hand if you happen to be here for the first time? You are? Hello. Welcome. We greet you. We have this packet. Did you get this? Okay, good. There's a card in there, and if you fill that out, Pastor Tony loves to receive those on your way out. He wants to be able to say hello, and everybody wants to be able to say hello. So everyone say hello to our guest. Hello, welcome. We're glad you are here this morning. There are some great ways that we can connect, not only with our guests, but with this family, and that is to text connect. Oh, where's my phone? Here's my phone. See this phone? Cell phone. Yep, cell phone. 757-320-5615. Text connect, and you will be connected to what's happening here at Open Door and never miss a beat and never miss a thing. I always love getting those reminders on Sunday morning that we get to celebrate Jesus together as a family, and that's incredible. There's also lots of other things you can do with your phone, and one of the things that we are so proud to be part of in this body is generosity. We love to give our tithes. We love to give our offering. We are a giving church. We give to the community. We give to the world, and there's some easy ways for you to connect with generosity, and that is to text GIVE to 757-320-5555. You can use your phone and go to odcsuffolk.com/give. You can do your bill pay through your bank. You can mail a check. You can drop it off at the office. You can put it in one of the buckets at the back table. Lots of ways that we can give. And one of the ways that we can be generous is our food ministry takes donations all throughout the month. And this month, our donation is May 21st. That is when we're going to be doing our food distribution. So if you would like to participate with that, you can donate money, and that helps them get fresh supplies and fill in any gaps. Or you can make a point to bring in some extra food, and there's a shopping cart in the back that we can fill up so that we can help the community meet all of their needs. Doesn't that sound great? Sounds great. We have an opportunity coming up. Sister Teresa Wicks has a table set up in the back. Would you just stand up real fast so everybody knows who you are? This is Sister Teresa Wicks. She has a table set up in the back, and she is heading up the Crisis Pregnancy Center Walk for Life fundraiser for Open Door Church. Lots of churches participate, lots of organizations. She's heading it up for us. So if you're interested in sponsoring or walking and raising money for the Crisis Pregnancy Center, please go to the back table and she will fill you in on all of the details for that. That walk is going to be June 4th. And National Day of Prayer is this Thursday, May 5th. So plan accordingly. There's lots of places you should be able to go to do that. Our nurseries are dismissed right after praise and worship. 0 and 3 are going to exit to the left, and the infants are going to go all the way down the hallway, and it's the last door on the left. And then the toddlers are going to go into the fellowship hall and enter in through that way. And then our lovely children, 4 to 12, are going to go into the foyer where their teachers take them up to their class. Who is ready to stand back on your feet? Everybody! Yay! Do it! All right.
Amen. The last song we sang had a line in it. I said, we'll see his goodness in the land of the living. And I remember growing up and we'll sing songs like I'll Fly Away and things like that. And, it, you know, heaven is something that we definitely look forward to and we're excited about, but also we will see his goodness in the land of the living. So I embrace that. I speak that over my life. It's in the book of Psalms. I'm not exactly sure which psalm it is, but definitely it's in the land of the living. We'll see his goodness. Amen. And we talked a few weeks ago about we don't give God praise, that the rocks would cry out. And I don't want to let the rocks do my job or what I am just passionately want to pursue. I'm not going to let a rock cry out when I can give my voice and my praise to Jesus. So this morning we're singing about Rock of Ages. So he is the rock. But you guys, let your voices resound nice and loud today. We're going to sing to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Thank you.
trust you, Lord. We know, God, that you never sleep nor slumber. Thank you, Lord, for always being aware and awake. Thank you, Lord. Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe. Yes, we can see. Yeah. Wonders are still what you do. Bodies are still. Oh, God.
Miracles happen when you move. Heaven is coming. Miracles happen when you move. Heaven is coming.
all about you, Jesus. From beginning to the end, it will be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus. Nothing else matters.
Jesus, you're the center. God has a word this morning. I believe this is for someone specific. He says, you've been doubting me. Every promise in my word is for you. And he says to you, do not doubt me. I am there. I see you. It will come to pass. This is not your timing. This is my timing. Every promise I have given you. And God says, I spoke to you yesterday. This is your confirmation. I will not leave you or forsake you. Put your eyes on me. Do not look at what's going on around you.
Amen. Hallelujah. Let's just stay in this beautiful attitude of worship, right? For those of you who don't know, first Sunday of every month is Communion Sunday. I like to think of it as a celebration. So we're going to get ready to take communion. And if anybody does not have one of these little cups, put your hand up and somebody will get you one quickly. Everyone got one? All right, awesome. So I always try to come up with something interesting to say for communion. So in the celebration of this sacrament, we receive the renewed assurance of the forgiveness of our sins and our fellowship with Christ. Unite with one another as members of his body and rejoice in the hope of his return to glory. Therefore, we will commune faithfully and thus renew our pledge of allegiance to him. And these are some things that kind of happen when we, what you can think about when we're taking communion, or the Lord's Supper, as they call it. It is a vivid reminder of Christ's broken body and shed blood. This is all taken out of Matthew 26 and 1 Corinthians 11. We meditate on Christ's death on our behalf. Okay? It's a time of affirmation that we are participants in Christ's sacrifice. It's a reminder that someday we will be with the risen Christ in his Father's kingdom. It is the proclamation that Christ will come again. Amen? it brings to our minds that the new covenant in which all true believers participate was established by Christ's sacrifice of his flesh and his blood. This new covenant carries both great privileges and important responsibilities. It's a time of rich fellowship for the body of Christ in which we affirm that though we are many, though we are many, we are one. God is a universal God. He's not just the God of America. He's not just the God of the Middle East or Russia or Ukraine or all the countries in Africa. He's a universal God, which means he wraps his arms around the whole world. And that sacrifice is for everyone, not just who we think it should be for, but it's for everyone. I heard somebody say that the arms of the gospel are wide. The arms of the gospel are wide because they reach to everyone. Come on, it reaches to everyone on earth. Not just those who believe, but to even those who do not believe at this time. It reaches to everyone. The afterthought of that is the truth is narrow. Because the truth is Jesus is the only way to heaven. And we have to accept that sacrifice on our behalf to enjoy the richness of his kingdom. So salvation is for everyone. The blood of Christ is for everyone. The beatings are for everyone. For every sin that was committed and every sin that will be committed until the end of our natural time. So, the gospel is wide. The gospel is so wide. But the truth is narrow. And the truth is Jesus is the only way to heaven. And the world will argue with that. The world will say there's many ways to heaven. But the truth of the matter is that Jesus is the only way. He is the only way. And that's why we take communion, because it reminds us of that. It says, do this in remembrance of me, of the sacrifice that I made, of what I did for you. Come on, of what I did for you. You know, it wouldn't matter if there was one person left on earth. Jesus still would have went to the cross. Amen? If there was only one person left, he still would have went. And we have to have that mentality, as if you were the last person on earth, I want you to know that Jesus did it all for you. He did it all for you. Not that you would have a rough life, or that you wouldn't be able to do what you wanted to do. He wants you to enjoy life to the fullest in his kingdom, because his way is the best way. I can tell you that. Man, over 20 years of marriage, I can tell you that his way is the best way, because there's no way I could have done it without him. I'm telling you the truth. There's no way. She agrees. There's no way. There's no way. And I'm telling you, it is the best life. This life in Jesus is the best life. Amen. So on the night that Jesus was betrayed, took the bread, and we don't have bread, we have these wonderful wafers. Delicious. He said, on the night as he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples that were up there in the room with him, and he said, "This is my body that was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And they partook of the bread. Hallelujah. And I just want to say, if you don't know Jesus today, today is your day. Don't walk out wondering. Don't walk out with a question mark of, well, am I or am I not? No, today is your day. Amen? Today is your day. And after they took the bread, he took the cup. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink." This is the cup of salvation that was coming. This was the cup of the new covenant that brought us back into right relationship with God Almighty, our Father. Hallelujah. And they took the cup and they drank. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for us, Lord. Thank you for all that you're going to do, God. Thank you for bringing those into the kingdom that don't yet know who they are. But you know who they are, Lord, and you are going to bring them in. Thank you, Jesus.
We all love you, John Moore.
Praise the Lord. We're going to dismiss our children now, so if you guys would just quietly slip out. We are a kid-friendly church. Just want to welcome all the guests. If I didn't get to meet you before, I'll meet you at the door on the way out. We'll have order in a moment. I want to talk to you today about being centered. That's why we sang that song. And we gave you a little tool early in the year. If you didn't get one, it's in the Welcome Center, 10 challenges for us in 2022. And we're hearing people say it's really helping them. It's So if you don't have one, stop by the Welcome Center and get one of these. And one of the top things is pray for members daily, share your faith this week, read your Bible devotionally, listen to people more, have an attitude of thankfulness, practice forgiveness, be an encourager, an edifier, be an example and a disciple of Jesus Christ. In other words, be a better Christian, laugh more, and take injustice seriously. So something hit me. My wife was talking last week about the heart, and it just kind of been on me all week, just working on this. And so I want to talk about being centered today. There's a lot that goes into that. And happened so, I've run across a couple little pieces in some real paper here. You folks are so used to me using my computer here. But this talks about how the church fathers read the Bible. And it says this, the church fathers, it's talking about the first century guys that were interpreting the Bible, abandoned their inherited cultures of Greece and Rome. That's what had been driving their lives, the gods of Greece and Rome, and embraced their God-given identity as the new Israel. Like them, we must be prepared to lay aside our traditions and prejudices and allow our minds to be transformed by the message given to the prophets and the apostles who wrote the Bible. I just thought that was just powerful. They abandoned something that they'd been used to, something that was really etched into their lives from the time they were born. And then in this another piece in this particular book that I was reading out of, this little magazine, talks about two people that encounter the Word of God. And there was this guy named Emile Callier, which is a French guy. He was raised in naturalistic France. The first time he ever saw a Bible, he was 23 years of age. He had a longing, though, for self-understanding. So during World War I, he spent long watch nights in foxholes. In a strange way, he had been longing, as it may sound, an unusual longing, for a book that would understand me, he says. But he said, I knew of no such book. So Calais set out to build his own book, to construct one, he said. He said, now I would in secret prepare one for my own private use. And over time, he constructed a book made up of quotations drawn from literature and philosophy. In the end, however, when he read his compilation, he found only disappointment. It carried no strength of persuasion. Instead of insight, he found emptiness. Amazing, trying to fix his own problems. The only person who can fix your problems is Jesus. Around that same time, his wife, thank God for wives, right? John Mark, thank God for wives, right? Around the same time, his wife happened on a Protestant church. She went in and met the elderly pastor, a la me, elderly. As Callier relates the story, she walked to his desk and heard herself say, have you a Bible in French? Indeed, he said. Callier's wife, upon his return home, the wife gave Callier a copy of the Bible. He vividly describes what happens next. This is just amazing. I literally grabbed the book and rushed to my study with it. I opened it and chanced upon the Beatitudes, Matthew 6. I could not find words to express my awe and wonder, and suddenly the realization dawned upon me, this was the book that would understand me. I needed it so much, yet unaware I had attempted to write my own in vain. I continued to read deeply into the night and mostly from the Gospels. A decisive insight flashed through my whole being the following morning as I probed the opening chapters of the Gospel according to John. The very clue to the secret of human life was discovered right there. Not stated in some foreboding language of philosophy, but in common, everyday language of human circumstances. This guy became a very noted Christian thinker after that. But he grabbed this book his wife gave to him, and it changed his life. It changed his life. It spoke to the very need of his life. It helped him understand who he was. When Jesus Christ came on the scene, he came in a very powerful way, obviously, and he began to challenge the world that was in front of him. Just 1 second. Hopefully that works. It doesn't work. All right. I'm locked out of my computer. But I have a secondary way. I'll start printing my stuff up next time. So I want to talk about being centered today. Staying centered. Being centered. The main thrust of Jesus' ministry was to keep people centered, or to get people back to the center. As we read the first passage, or the first story there, that the Romans and the Greeks were raised in a culture that established their center point, their following of other gods and traditions that were that day. But I want to talk about this word centered, and I'm going to give you a couple of definitions quickly. It means to be emotionally stable and secure. It's the middle point of a circle or sphere, equidistant from every point, the circumference of the surface. The point from which an activity or process is directed or which is focused, the place in the middle. Hence the song, Jesus, you're the center of my life, right? Jesus is the center. And everything that happens around us every single day is constantly trying to draw us away from Jesus being the center. Jesus being the focal point. Jesus being the nucleus. Jesus being the middle of the bullseye. Jesus being the thing that's the most important. Jesus from Jesus being the hub, the heart, the nucleus, the epicenter. Jesus is all those things. But from the garden to today, there's been things trying to push us away, draw us away, nudge us away from the center of Jesus Christ. So to be in the center, to be balanced, to have our equilibrium proper and right, we have to have an understanding of who God is, an understanding of what God's Word says about things. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 11, verse 1, and then we're going to read Proverbs 20, verse 23, if we put these on the screen. Because this is kind of where we live today. This is what is being shot out to us every day. This is what you're hearing on the news, what you're seeing on the news, what you're seeing happening in the world. Same as the people of Jesus' day when they came into life. A false balance is an abomination to the Lord. But a just weight is his delight. Divers weights are an abomination to the Lord, and a false balance is not good. And everything about life today is trying to keep us off balance. And if I might say it this way, the church many times looks like it's got vertigo. Stumbling and staggering all over the place, not knowing what is real, not knowing what is truth and what is not truth. And you know, they asked Jesus about that, and he says, Jesus talks about truth. What is truth? That Jesus is truth. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes into the Father but by him. But everything in life is pushing us away, drawing us away, feeding things into us, whether we read it or see it or hear it or in where we work at. Everything is pushing us or drawing us away, trying to nudge us away from the center and what truth is all about. You understand? Does it make sense to you? You read the paper, and everything's trying to move you away. Someone sent me an advertisement this week and about, I think it was about life or being fixated on life or something like that. But in that quick little 30-second ad, it's got all kind of things in there, but it's talking about you're the person that fulfills your own life. That's what Calais thought. He could fulfill his own life, but he got very empty, and he couldn't even write a book that would meet the needs of his life. But if you look at that, that ad that I'm talking about, you'll see it. I think it was AT&T. Is that right? A Fitbit. But it displays all kind of lifestyles. It's just kind of shooting them in there real quick that this is okay and that's okay and this is okay. Listen, folks, every lifestyle is not okay. I'm going to say that again. I said every lifestyle is not okay. Every lifestyle can be forgiven, but every lifestyle is not supposed to stay a part of your life. But the world is pushing us away from godly lifestyle. The godly center, the godly hub, the godly nucleus, the godly core of everything. The world is pushing us away or drawing us away or nudging us away or just trying to get us off of our balance. So we just kind of we're just like this, and all of a sudden we'll just fall. We'll fall for what they're talking about. And so when my wife was talking last week, this word centered came to me, and I thought about this, and everything Jesus Christ did, every time he spoke, everywhere he went, everything was about him trying to bring them back to the center. You think about it, back to the center of what was really important, back to the center of what was really would make the difference, back to the center of what he thought was best for them. Everything. You read the Gospels, Jesus is constantly bringing correction or bringing adjustment or drawing them back to what really is important. And I'm finding out, and as I listen to people and I read things and I see things, that people don't really understand what's important anymore. Everything else is important, but except what Jesus said. I'm not here to regurgitate something Jesus said and make it different. I'm not going to make it different. I'm going to tell you like he said it, like he talked about it. I mean, either the Word of God is inspired or it's not. Either Jesus is real or he's not. Come on, or he's a liar, or he's a fake, or he's a false. But I believe Jesus is real. And I believe what he said and what he stood for is real. And I think it's just as real today as it was when he came. Come on. It's just as real today as it was when he created earth in the beginning. It's the same. Even from the very beginning, if you go back to the garden, come on, think about this. God says, you can have every tree in the garden that's in the midst of the garden. Come on, in the midst of the garden. But you can't have the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You have everything else, but not that one. Because that one is not centered. That one has bias. That one has prejudice. That one has freedom for your own interpretation. But if you get a hold of the tree of life, there's only one. Come on. There's only one way of seeing things, and that's God's way of seeing things. What the Word of God says, how God's heart is towards something. But if you go the other route, it's going to tilt one way or the other, because that one relates to the scales of justice. Nobody in this world can live impartial. God is the only one that's impartial. You don't believe that, do you? Do you believe that? But the world has their own idea of what is right and what is just and what is okay. And you know what happens? When you go the world's way, or the way the Romans wanted to do, or the Greeks wanted to do, or any other world power that's ever been, then you're always going to be skewed, and you're always going to be led off into some looseness of life that is not biblical. Some thinking about life that is not biblical. You know, they have the table set up in the back for Crisis Pregnancy Center. I'm a man that believes that Jesus Christ is about life. People that believe in abortion, they just believe in their life. They don't believe about other people's lives. They don't think the baby has a right. If I'm on your toes, then fine. Lifestyle. God gives us a lifestyle in the scriptures, right? Are you scared? Am I pushing you back to the center a little bit here? It's uncomfortable to get back to the center. Listen, it costs when you go downtown to get your tires realigned or your car realigned. It costs a little money. It costs for God to get you back into the center. It's not always comfortable. Or how about you people that had to go get braces because your teeth were not centered? Was that painful? Was it painful? Who had braces in here? How about all the Davis girls, all of them, the whole crew? Was it painful to get you back in line, right? And what's the dentist say? He says, we're trying to get everything back in line. So sometimes back in line, I mean, they had to pull some teeth out. No, not take your, don't take my teeth out. Come on. I want those things. But to get things back in center, sometimes you got to remove some stuff. Sometimes you got to put some force on some stuff. Sometimes you got to move, got to put some pressure on stuff. Come on. So if we don't put some pressure on some stuff that's going on, we're just going to continually be like a top that's just spinning out of control. And that's what I think sometimes. I think the church, like I said, we have spiritual vertigo. We're just kind of like over here, and then we're over here. We have to call things what they are. We have to call sin out. We have to call out with mercy for them to repent, for people to come to know the Lord. I had my own things to deal with. You understand? Which I thought was okay to do, or at least my mind would, my flesh would let me say it was okay to do. But I was telling a friend of mine today, when I first got saved, I mean, God just began to just strip things away from me that were not godly at all. Listen, if you see a convertible going down the road, you have no misconception about that being a convertible, do you? Because the top's down. Right? If the top is up, it's a convertible with the top up. But when you take the top down, this is truly what you call a convertible. It's open. I think that when we get converted, when we come to know Jesus Christ, there should be some definite understanding or knowledge or difference in the way we look or the way we act and the way the rest of the culture lives and acts and does and talks. Come on. My lifestyle can't be like the lifestyle of the culture I came out of. I can't have one foot in and one foot out. I'm not living a balanced life like that. I'm living a divided life. The power of the knowledge of good and evil. That's not going to get it done, people. Because if I know good and evil, I can do both, and that doesn't save me. That doesn't make me godly. That doesn't make me a believer. Just makes me believe that I can do what I want to, and I want to, and it's not good for me, I do what I want to. I don't want to do it. But Jesus has lifestyle. Jesus has principle. Jesus has a culture for us to live, not the world culture, but His culture. And so I begin to think about this. I begin to meditate about this, and I was telling telling Sarah this morning upstairs about when I get in these trains here that, and she knows better than any of you do, that I just write verses down after verse, and she's got a litany of verses like this. So we're just going to try to go through some of them this morning just to kind of mess with them. But I want us to think about balance for just a moment. Taking everything into account is what balance means. Fairly judging things that are presented, being impartial, levelness, equilibrium, a state of adjustment between opposing divergent influences. We need balance. Jesus gave us balance when He gave us the Word. He gave us the Word to help us in the balance of life, to help us live the right way. And so if you think about the scales of truth that you see, you know, as a blind lady holding the scales, and truth and justice is what they are. So the scales of truth, it's a lady that's blindfolded. That means we're not supposed to be biased or prejudiced towards people. That's what that is. When you come to court, I'm not supposed to see what you look like. I'm not supposed to see you male, female, black, white, brown, you know, or an Asian, I don't, or who, whoever. I'm not supposed to see you as a rich or a poor person, dressed nice or not dressed. I'm not supposed to see any of that, because if I see you that way, then I am imbalanced towards you, always. It's true. So when Jesus came on the scene, he literally came and he looked at things completely blindfolded, without any bias, prejudice, and partiality towards anyone, anything, at any time. No matter where you came from, no matter what you looked like, no matter your culture, no matter if you were even a mixed breed like the Samaritans. He didn't look at you that way. He didn't look at you as a male and a female. I hate that about churches, that the females get the they're second-class Christians. Females are not second-class Christians. There's neither male nor female in the kingdom of God. Hello? Fellas, your wife is not a second-class person. She's your wife. She's the other. She's your half. She's part of you. The two shall what become one flesh. So we got to stop looking at the ladies as second-class. We have to stop looking at the children as second-class, because Jesus said, suffer the children to come unto me. You see how Jesus is constantly trying to adjust the way they thought about things? The disciples said, hey, can you get the kids out of here? They're driving me crazy. Don't you know the sound of voices is a good thing? The sound of kids is a good thing in the church. They might aggravate you, annoy you, but it's the sound of a good thing. That means there's life in the house. Come on. There's life in the house. If you don't want life in the house, there's not going to be a house later on. Is that true? So let the kids yell. Let them scream. Let them roll on the floor. It's better than them rolling on a bar somewhere. Come on, come on. We'll call them holy rollers at 3 years old. I mean, I'm just trying to help you think a little bit differently. I'm just trying to make you just look. When you read the scriptures, think about what I'm talking about. That Jesus is trying to make you see it his way and not your way, not the way that's portrayed during that day. And then there was the scales. There was the truth of the scales. What was real, where the baseline was, the core, the heart of the thing, the center point. And then there was the sword, which meant there was going to be justice served properly. It was not going to be with malice or envy or strife or impartiality. It's going to be what's supposed to be measured out, dealt with the proper way, which was by the Word of God. So I want us to think about this for a little bit. And all this, you know, Proverbs 31 or 30, we just read a few minutes ago about the false balance and abomination. All that this stuff, you know, is very important, because it helps us see things differently. In Deuteronomy 32:4, this will give a baseline here for who God is. He is the rock. Deuteronomy 32:4. He is the rock. His work is perfect. All his ways are judgment, a God of truth, without iniquity. He's just and he's right. That's who we serve. And as we read the scriptures, Jesus is constantly attempting to reset and to realign and to adjust and to bring the disciples into the Pharisees. Listen, not only the disciples, but the scribes, the Pharisees, the people of the day, every single person. He's doing the same thing for all of them, because they all have got a skewed, imbalanced, unaligned worldview of things. Everybody does. For instance, this is just a sidebar. Peter says to Jesus, Peter says, you can't go to the cross. What did Jesus say? Get behind me, Satan. That's a heck of an adjustment, isn't it? You know what that lets you know? That lets you know that Peter, as powerful as he was, he didn't know the way he should be looking at the situation. Oh, yeah, we're crying for a Messiah. We're crying for a Savior. We're crying for a King. Here he is. He said, but you can't do this the way you think you should do it, or the way you're supposed to do it. You can do it my way. And Peter stayed on that same course. They go to get Jesus in the garden, and what happens? Peter rises up, takes his sword, cuts the high priest's ear off, and Jesus has to rebuke him again.
because he doesn't know where center point is. He doesn't know what this is really about. He's still missed the point. Jesus does a miracle, puts the priest's ear back on, which I think, how in the world can they still haul him off after that? So miracles don't really change anybody's mind most of the time. Hello. You can run after miracles if you want to. Miracles are supposed to, miracles are supposed to run after you. You're not supposed to run after miracles. And that's still not enough. Peter still didn't get it. Little girl down by the fireplace says, "Hey, Peter, aren't you one of Jesus' followers?" "Oh no, I've never seen a man in my life." And then guess what happens? The cock crows. He goes into some remorseful, repentant, sad heart because now he finally got it. And that's just a couple of the instances where Jesus has to have a little encounter adjustment with Peter. James and John. Mom says, "Hey, listen, let them sit on the right hand and the left hand." They said, "Well, let's call some fire from heaven down on people. Let's kill them. Let's get rid of them." "Hey, guys, you don't know what you're talking about." Some of you are kind of judgmental like that. You just want to wipe everybody out. You'd be left. That'd be the easy way out, but then you'd be stuck with yourself. Then you'd be like the guy that I just read about from France, and then you're lost. Because your way didn't work. Jesus is constantly, constantly, constantly adjusting these people. And just it's amazing to me that this centering, this adjustment, calibrating their lives, he's doing this all the time. See, Jesus came to give us life. And he came to give us life more abundantly. John 10:10. Let's look at that. The thief comes to what? To steal, kill, and to destroy. But I'm come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And when you read the scriptures and the gospels and the stories that Jesus Christ inserts himself in, they are definitely not trying to bring life in situations. They're not trying to help the situation. One of my all-time favorite stories is when they bring the woman that's caught in adultery. You've heard this 100 times from me at least. When they bring the woman caught in adultery, they're not interested in saving the lady. They're not interested in looking at a bigger picture of what might have happened in the situation. This is my big thing about this. I still want to know where the guy is that they caught her in adultery with. He ain't recorded. He ain't talked about, but they want to kill her. Because they have come to a place to understand in their interpretations of scriptures and how they've changed elasticized scripture or the law, that they can we'll just kill her. We'll kill her. We'll stone her. We won't see any mercy. We'll just look at her for what she is. And what does Jesus say? Adjustment. Come on. Recalibrate. Hello. Hello. If there's one of you, without sin, because they're remembering now what it says in the law. It says if you break one of these laws, what? You broke them all. Now they found her and she's broke a law, so she's broke them all. But he says this. But by the way, guys. Are you spanking white clean? Are you without a flaw? Have you never made a mistake? Have you never fallen in anything? And they looked at each other, probably, and they looked at the woman, looked at the stones in her hand, and said, "Whoop, I guess that we need to just leave. I guess there's no room for us to accuse her, let alone stone her." And Jesus was adjusting their thought pattern right then. He was realigning their lives to look at things biblically. According to God's word. And I think this is so important because think about it, people. Think about how many times you look at a situation and you prejudge it. Think of it how many times you see a situation and you're partial towards whatever's going on. Think about a situation when things didn't go your way and you lose your mind, literally. You lose your mind. You lose your focus. You lose everything. And you just blow up and all over the place and make a mess like a volcano. Jesus has to come and
refocus us. He has to realign us. He has to bring us back to the center points, like, you know, the wrath of man doesn't work the righteousness of God. Come on. Vengeance is not your responsibility, but he'll take care of it. Come on. And he'll do a better job than you will. Because by the time he's finished working on you, you're going to probably love that person. And by the time he's finished working in the situation and trying to adjust their life, they're going to probably come to a place of repentance. And guess what? You guys might be best friends. But you don't want to give that opportunity.
Just get rid of him. I don't have to worry about him anymore. I just think,
I want to tell you something. I want you to read the Bible and ask the Lord to adjust you as you read. When you read the Bible, ask the Lord to rebalance you, recalibrate your life. Because I guarantee if you do, you will find out some things are going on in your life. You're thinking some ways. You're doing some stuff that you need to stop doing. And quit thinking the way you're thinking. I promise you. Jesus spent all this time there on the side of the mountain, the Sermon on the Mount, teaching them how it should be done. That's the important thing. He taught them how to do things first. He just say, just go try it. It's like he didn't rebuke them for doing the wrong thing. He teaches them how to do it. Then he, you know what he does? After he teaches them how to do it, he by mapping out a picture, like here's what it looks like. Here's what you're supposed to do. Here's how you're supposed to handle this. And then Jesus showed them how to do it. So it doesn't do me any good just to give you the information, does it? Because information is not transformation. So I give you the information. Then Jesus said, you know what? I'm going to help you guys do it. We're going to do it together. We're going to show you how this looks. Right? That's called discipleship. And then after I show you how it looks and we do it together, after you know how it's supposed to be done, then I'm just going to leave and let you do it. That's called maturity. So what did Jesus do? He says, I must needs go, right? I must needs go to the Father, right? And I'm going to leave you what? The Holy Spirit. And he's going to walk alongside you, and he's going to help you do this as I've instructed you, as I've showed you, as if we've done it together. But most of, I think, Christian life that we have, we kind of live outside the influence of the Holy Spirit. And he's trying to influence us so much, and we're so resistant because we have a cultural ridge, a cultural thought pattern in our mind that just almost will not let us go there because it's so foreign. There's certain words I can say to you right now. If I said some certain words, the hair would stand up on your back. If I say injustice to you, some of you get mad. If I say righteousness to some of you, you're going to say, yeah. But what really is the difference? Because they both want the same thing, don't they? You with me? If I say godly lifestyle, You had a picture of that, right? But the lifestyle of the world is not the same thing as a godly lifestyle. Is that true? And you can't, they can't, listen. Whew. Where am I going to go here? Just move to this right quick. You remember a few weeks ago, if you were interested or you stayed up, you watched the Oscars. Who watched the Oscars? Nobody cares about the Oscars. There are about four people. I don't know Oscar either, but you know I like to see what they're doing, see how crazy they are. But everybody knows about the slap, right? Okay, everybody knows, but you know about the slap. I just want to tell you something. Chris Rock did exactly, I don't know anything about him spiritually, but Chris Rock did exactly what the Bible said to do, which is nothing. Nothing. What did Chris Rock do? He like, and he said a few choice words, but he kind of composed himself and continued on. I'm sitting in there, I'm watching this with my wife, and I said, I don't think I could have done what Chris Rock did. I've been preaching for 42 years. I don't think I could have just stood there. How many feel like that? Come on, tell the truth. Shame the devil, tell the truth. Yeah, I don't think I could. We'd have been at it right there. And we would have needed Denzel to come and separate us and pray for us. But can you think about what happened and what he did? Plus, he's universally around the world embarrassed. Well, Jesus says this, if somebody slaps you, do what? What? Are you serious? No, I'm fighting. Come put your dukes up, man. Come on, let's go. Let's go a few rounds. I'm going to be Tyson Fury just for a few moments. I'm going to knock you out. Come on. You don't know who this is. I'm going to be Muhammad Ali. I'm going to sting you like a bee. Come on. But just think about what we want to fight. I mean, we want to rear up inside. We want to give our two cents in this thing. Well, listen, we just need to sometimes just shut up. Control yourself. Allow the Lord to bring you into balance. And when he does, you won't act the fool. So who lost out in the slap? Who lost out? Smith lost out. Smith lost out, right? Who gained? Chris Rock. Two nights later, they're paying $1,000 a seat to get in to see him. $1,000. Are you serious? But Jesus, he told the disciples kind of the same thing. Listen, turn the other cheek. Whoever's without sin, cast the first stone. Turn the other cheek. I mean, my gosh. Jesus does this all through the Beatitudes. Sermon on the Mount, he's telling them what to do in situations. Let's see if I can pull out a few here. Let's look at this quickly. In the Sermon on the Mount, he goes in some of this stuff. He challenges their thought, their practice, their tradition, their culture, their establishment, whatever. He challenges all this because they're so off-center. They're just so reeling all over the place. And even today, churches are trying to figure out what is truth and what's not truth and what they're supposed to do and what they're not supposed to be doing. And they made their own way, like the scribes and the Pharisees. They made their own way. They've done their own thing. They found exceptions to different things. Like the Pharisees found a way to get out of a marriage with someone after 23 years that they had a problem with. Like, this was one of the things they said, if your wife was a bad cook, you could divorce her. I got an answer for that. If your wife can't cook, you learn how. If neither one of you can cook, then just go get Grubhub. Get it delivered. Go out to eat. Eat some crunchy chicken. But why do we want to make excuses to get out of our mess, out of our conundrums? Like, what's wrong with you? But they were trying to do this all the time. They're always trying to make exceptions to do what they want to do. And believe me, we do a lot of self-justification. Let's look at this in Matthew 5. I'm going to have to stop here somewhere. Matthew 5, 19 to 20. I want the worship team to get up here. That'll help us stop, right? Whoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so to do the same thing, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Think about that. That's powerful. Listen, folks, we have to raise the bar a little bit. We have to raise the level of what life looks like. Then he goes on to 5:21. Just kind of give you a couple excerpts here while they're getting up here. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, you shall not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. And he goes on to talk about how that is not the way they want to live. Then Matthew 5:27-28. You have heard that it was said then. Now listen, you've heard that it was said. That's an important phrase there. You've heard that it was said. That means these guys, the scribes and the Pharisees of the day, they have realigned things. They've changed alignment. They've changed the level of the line of truth, so to speak. You've heard that it was said of them of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looks on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Uh-oh. You got to change the way you look at people completely and totally. Just because you didn't hop in the sack with them didn't mean that you ain't had some ideas in your head about something. Hello? He says, you got to get this thing completely out of your head. And if you can't, then don't go where you see women. Or don't go where you see men, ladies. That's the bottom line. Just stay away from these places that might draw your brains away. Matthew 5:38. You have heard that it was said before. Again, something that they said. Listen to this. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Tit for tat. But I say unto you that you resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite you on the right cheek, turn to him what? The other one. And if any man shall sue thee at the law, take away your coat, let him have your coat and your cloak. Whosoever shall compel thee to go 1 mile, go 2 miles. Give to him that asked thee, and from him that hath would borrow of thee, thou shalt not away. Wow. In other words, why do we look at doing the minimum when Jesus Christ says, do more? Don't we try to figure out how we can do the least that's necessary? We do, don't we? There's people that go to school, and they could be A students, but they don't become A students because they don't want to do what's necessary to become an A student. They'd be just happy to get out, happy to be a C student. We have guys that play football down the street. They want to be on the team, but they don't want to do the necessary things, Ronnie, to make them winners. They think that they're just going to look at the weights in the weight room and they're going to become muscular. They think that. No, they really do. They think that if they walk around like they got, you know, lead in their shoes, that they're going to be faster, and they're not. And they're going to have great wind, and they're going to be able to run all night long. And they think that if they just drink a little bit of water during the game time, it's going to be enough to keep them from getting cramps. It's not. I didn't even know this, and I'm an athlete. I was going to college to be a coach. We didn't know this much about stuff, but they said this: if you don't want to get cramps, then drink water all week and a lot of it. Because just a little bit of water during the game is not going to help you with your cramps. In high school, they don't have IVs. They can drag you off and pump IVs in you like doing the pros, because the pros have the same problem. But listen, folks, if you don't want to dehydrate, you don't have cramps, drink water. If you don't want your skin to shrivel up, drink water. Serious? You think I'm kidding? Drink water. Let me try to finish this up. They're up here now, right? You know what we're singing, right? Okay. Let's read this one. Let's all stand to your feet. I just got to quit. Otherwise, if we stay, I'm going to do the whole all the Beatitudes. I'll do the whole thing, the whole Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5:43. You have heard it been said. This is what you've heard. You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Come on, what does it say? Love your neighbor, hate your enemy. That's cool. Where did that come from? It came out of convenience. We're just going to change it. I'll love the people I can love. The people I can't love, I'm just going to hate them. They said that at church. But Jesus said, love your what? Say it real loud. Love your, come on. Bless them that do what? Curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray, pray, be spiritual. Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be who? Children of your Father which is in heaven, for he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good and sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same? If you salute your brethren only, what do you more than the others? Do not even the publicans the same? But be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven perfect. In other words, be imitators of Christ. Be imitators of Christ, which always lived in the center. He lived in the center. When he was crucified, at the crossroads of the known world that day. I want you to ask the Lord right now. Just lift your hands up before we sing this song. Ask the Lord right now. Say, Lord, I want you to help me become more centered. Lord, I want you to help me become more balanced. Lord, I want you to help me deal with things from the hub of your thoughts, from the nucleus of your thoughts, from the heart of your thoughts. Lord, I pray right now that you recalibrate me. Lord, I pray right now that you adjust me and continue to adjust me, continually keep me in the center of your word, of your will, and your way for my life, that I might be the person, that we might be the people that represent what is godly, what is righteous, and what is just. That it won't be our own ideas. It won't be like this Camille guy. But that we'll read the scriptures and we'll adhere to the scriptures, and we won't look to try to finagle the scriptures or manipulate the scriptures to say what we want to say or to make it align with what the culture wants to say, but we will stand by the scriptures as written. We will stand by your word as spoken. We will stand by your life as lived. Because Jesus, you're the center of my life. Let's sing that song. Come on.
Jesus at the center of it all.
Come on, lift your hands up as we sing that. Come on, all over.
Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been.
I can't hear y'all singing that. Come on, sing it, people. Come on.
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus.
on, make this a prayer right now.
Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it will always be you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves around you. Jesus, you. From my heart,
come on,
to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes.
Come on, drive it in your hearts right now.
From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about
from my heart.
From my heart to my heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, 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 it's all about you. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, be the center.
There it is, right there. Right there, come on.
Jesus, be the center of your church. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, shall confess you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Bless your name, Lord. Bless your name, Lord. Lord, we just pray right now, God. You be the center of our life. You be the center of your church, Lord. You be the center of our thinking, Lord. That you be the center of how we deal with things in life, Lord. We thank you, Lord, today that you came to show us what being the center looks like. And so, Lord, we ask you, we surrender right now. We bow to you, Lord, to help us live that way that you portrayed, that way that you showed us. As Paul said, that we might be imitators of Christ. That we'll be so in tune with him, people will see us as the hands and feet of Jesus. Let's see your love in us. And Father, we ask you today in Jesus' name that, Lord, you would help us live in the center. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand? I want you to love on somebody. Give somebody a hug. Tell them you love me before you go. God bless you.